I was told by many people, what are you doing? You're never going to grow bananas here. They're going to die. Like, you're wasting your money. And I thought to myself, well, hey, it'll be a fun experiment. Like, at the very least, we'll see what happens.
We were saying before that things just look like they're finally turning into that young forest feeling.
It's kind of my little getaway. I come out here most days, Byron rings me and I'm in my food forest. You know, it's just the way it is. Like I say, I spend most of my time out here observing. The actual management of the system doesn't take that long, so it's not like it's a massive effort. I could probably manage most of what you see here in this first system in the space of half a day as a chop and drop. You know, I can do pretty much everything, both the canopy and the shrubs, in half a day, and you just get faster as time goes on. Had grown across and touched, and to me that was amazing that I could get that much growth in such a short period of time. The space between things, because I've just kept it pruned. I've planted fruit trees in other places on the land where it's been, here's a fruit tree in the middle of this grass patch, and here's a fruit tree in the middle of this grass patch. And I've watched how long it's taken those fruit trees to get to even half the size of some of the plants that I've planted in this system. And you know, some of those plants are like 4 years old, whereas these ones are not even two. So,
do you have any advice for somebody who just wants to get started? They just need that next step. What's that thing that is holding most people back that you can offer some advice towards?
I think fundamentally it's just, you know, start. Like, actually go and pick a little piece of land, start small, chuck in twice as many support species as you do edible species, and just plant them and watch what happens. Observe what does well, observe what doesn't do well, and learn from it. And you know, you just have to pivot. If something doesn't do well, plant something else in its place, and just learn from it.
Lovely. Thank you, Brett. 17 months. There we go. He's the one who knows better than me. So 17 months ago, we planted this Syntropic food forest. We're going to take you guys for a little bit of a walk and see what's going on.
Yeah, so the only things that were here to start with were some avocado trees. There were four of them. They did get quite badly demolished by livestock, but have come back really strong and now getting some nice fruit on them.
So there was what? There was four or three existing avocados here.
Four, yeah.
In the middle of basically what was just a paddock. Kind of, and you can see in the broader landscape, we're in a gully. We're kind of at the top of a gully that has officially been closed off to livestock for how many, what, for 2 years now it's been closed off to livestock?
Yep.
And you've begun planting different rows, kind of creating some terraces.
Yeah, so originally we had along the barrier of this, we had Casuarina windbreak, and we first came through and took those down, took the tops off, because this was mostly shaded, especially in winter, so nothing here would have got a lot of sunlight. So we first took those trees down and then started to prep the soil, and mainly put cover crops down for the first 6 months. So there were things like lupin and just really green manure cover crops. So that was the start. And then come spring 2021, we planted out the first rows, which were basically this front row and this mid row. And then a couple of weeks later, we put in the support rows and the back row. So overall the system is roughly 17 months, roughly.
What's the total area for this
so
section?
The rows are roughly 40 to 50 meters long. Obviously the rows are about a meter wide for the main crop rows, and then obviously the support rows in between. If you have a look in the distance, we've got some really tall old eucalyptus trees in the background, which block out a lot of the afternoon sun. Especially in winter. So what we decided to do was plant more of the shade-loving crops down the bottom end and more of the sun-loving crops up the top end. So along the top end we've got the main crops as being things like citrus, because they need that sun in winter. We've planted things like casamora, white sapotes, and obviously some of the Jerusalem artichokes up front, because they like the sun, and bananas pretty much all through the system. So that's the top of the main crop is really just the citrus and the casamora. Have since kind of backfilled where there were holes, where things didn't make it through the frosts, because we had some awesome frosts here that killed things like inga beans and Just lost a fair amount of support species. A lot of Tithonia didn't like the frost very much here. So
you're pretty ambitious about what you were trying to grow here, knowing that you had frost. That's a consistent part of this growing climate.
I guess the thing is, like, I wanted to see how much I could get away with. And I found that out pretty harshly the first year. But have since kind of started new terraces and have learned from those mistakes and haven't put the more tender things into those rows. I've just put the support species in because that will allow us to create a canopy in a microclimate so that next year I can actually start putting in some of those higher value crops that need a bit more protection, a bit more shelter.
So you're kind of going in stages now, adding your support species and the more tolerant things, and then once there's a bit more support and protection from those frosts, then you go add the sensitive stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. Otherwise, it's just kind of throwing money down the toilet.
So. Yeah, and if it's not money, it's propagation material and propagation effort. So we'll keep taking a walk and seeing what we're seeing. But this is, and now, this is a syntropic food forest. What in your mind is the big difference between maybe a regular food forest or versus like a syntropic food forest? What are those main differences in your eyes?
So I think the syntropic fruit forests are basically us stepping in and increasing that cycle of getting the nutrients into the soil as fast as possible to take things that you grow as green manure, chopping them down, feeding the soil, making that cycle happen faster than nature would do it with winds coming through and taking branches off, etc. We are that disturbance of the system, and we come in and we do it as often as possible to put the nutrients back into the soil and enrich the soil as fast as possible on
the
cycle.
What does that look like very practically? Like, what species are you chopping and dropping? What does that management look like on the ground? Where are you putting that organic material?
Yeah, so if you can have a look at the front edge here, we've got a bunch of yacon. Now, yacon is obviously the Peruvian ground apple, so you can obviously eat the tubers that are grown. Don't know if I can find any right now because they're probably not quite ready, but I'm using this as a chop and drop because it does so damn well here that it's prolific, and I can basically get it to shoulder height in the beginning of spring and then chop it down and feed the system. And the way that I'm feeding the system is by putting the chop and drop on the edges but as close as I can to the midline, so you can see all of this lovely biomass breaking down and getting into the soil into that midline. So that's one of the support species. The other support species is obviously in the midline. So we've got the eucalyptus trees here. And you can see the pruning strategy is basically to strip it all the way up to a high crown so that we're creating a canopy, a protection layer for all of the undercrops, all of the understory seedlings and smaller trees. You know, got the barbaco and inga beans and some of the other understory crops here protected by that canopy, as well as the bananas.
And so the pruning of that looks quite different when you're in summer versus in winter. Like right now we're in summer, and so things are pruned quite high. You can see if you look down that way or if you look down this way, there's quite a lot of stratification between, you know, where the bottom of the canopy of the eucalypt is versus, you know, the canopy of the tamarillo or the avocado, right? You're allowing that sunlight in, whereas in winter, things look pretty different in here, and they will look a lot different this coming winter.
Yeah. Now, we've also just had Cyclone Gabby come through, and obviously as part of that process, we did quite a high prune to try and take the biomass off so that when the heavy winds came through, it didn't basically push everything over. There was less resistance against that wind. So that's why everything is a bit higher pruned right now. And I would generally have liked to have kept them a little bit lower than they are right now, but I was kind of struggling with the play of how heavy are these winds going to be, and do I want to save my trees or do I want more of a protection canopy over winter? So that was kind of the balance that I had to just struggle with and battle with. Down the midlines in these support rows, we've got poplar, which I'm going to intend on managing very much the same as the eucalyptus. So I'm going to basically be trimming all the branches up and creating a higher canopy, but not as, probably won't leave them to get as high as the eucs. just because all they're really protecting is the comfrey and the canna lilies, which aren't really going to be there through the winter anyways. But these will just create great biomass come spring and summer again.
So basically you're alternating an edible row, a support row, an edible row, support row, an edible row.
Yeah,
and in exactly. Your support row, you have the poplar as the support tree at whatever spacings, maybe 1 to 2 meters, 1.5 to 2 meter spacings, along with comfrey and canna lilies that are getting basically just chopped on a regular basis and fed into the edible rows.
Yeah, that's right. There's another couple of species in here, the Queensland arrowroot and also barna grass. But barna grass does not do as well for me here as the comfrey and the Queensland arrowroot. The cannas are doing okay, but again, probably my highest productive shrubby type support is my comfrey. Tithonia in summer, but not so much in winter. It doesn't like a frost here, so I pretty much have to repropagate that every spring and replant them out. But it just does so well in the growing season that it's worth repropagating every year for me. It just really is.
Mm. Next thing, sunflower. Worth it, even if you get a little bit of frost.
Yeah. What are the other supports? So obviously there's the Taxastae, which we've talked about.
The tree lucerne.
Tree lucerne.
What do you know? We were noticing that some of them were dying quite a bit around, and we're wondering if that just has to do with the clay layer that's in the subsoil.
Yeah, because when we first put these systems in, we did do quite a big disturbance, and we did add a lot of stuff, especially to these front two rows, not so much the back row, but the front two rows got a lot of, you know, manures and biochar and a lot of inputs, and then a lot of mulch over the top. And the Taxastae did really well growing into that to start with, but now clearly the roots have obviously hit the clay pan, and I think they're a little bit less happy with that. So on the back, you can see that some of the Taxastae are actually a lot happier, and I guess that's because they were planted directly into the clay pan to start with without as many additives to start with. A little bit more time to climatize, I think.
Even though the tree lucerne are dying after just a few, after a couple years, they're still doing a job. They're still providing a service in those first 2 years of roots in the soil, pumping sugars, fixing nitrogen, creating that microclimate, that overstory. And so even if they only last a couple years as a support species, it's still better that you've had them in the system for those first 2 years rather than not having them. There's still an overall benefit to the system, even if they're going to start dying after the first couple of years.
Mm. Yeah, I agree 100%. I mean, basically anything that you can be, that you can plant, that's harvesting that sunlight and pushing those sugars into the soil, do it. You know, if it can take up a piece of strata that you're not using, you know, it's perfect. It's great. Get it in there, and if you need to get more sunlight in, keep it pruned. You know, so. But you can see barna here. Last year, this barna would have been 3 times this height. Would have been a lot more lush. Because it was so badly frost damaged, it's really struggled to come back, and my climate doesn't like it. It may be that it actually does better this year because I've got more canopy now with the eucs for this winter.
So does better. Does see. Better in terms of surviving the frost this year.
Yeah. And I think maybe next year, you know, will be more vigorous, and I'll get more biomass out of it, like I did the first year. But yeah, we'll just have to wait and see. Really, it's all about observation. I spend more time in here just observing than I do actually doing any work on anything. I just watch and see. Yeah.
But how much do you reckon that has informed future management or future systems? Is just the amount of time that you spend? Because I'm quite similar. I spend a lot of time just observing things. And that time, while it might not seem productive in the short term, is actually really valuable in terms of guiding future moves and future installations.
I couldn't agree more. I mean, there's so many things that I would do differently, or at least do better. So, you know, for instance, the first year, the artichokes, sun artichokes, I basically just left them to get overhead height. and they ended up with really thick trunk bases that were not only a mission to actually manage at the end, but they had blocked out so much light that most of the seedlings didn't have enough light to actually survive. This year, I took the approach of just basically keeping them pruned, and I cut them low several times through the year, and everything underneath is a lot more happy, and it's not as hard to manage. So yeah, that's one thing. The other thing is actually the positioning of some of the trees, the support trees, in the rows. I would definitely in the future put my tree lucernes in the midline rather than on the edge, especially around bananas, because as the clumps get bigger and press up against the root systems of those tags, it just becomes harder to get the pups out. It's harder to manage.
I mean, so we can see even here, this banana was planted about maybe 40 centimeters away from a eucalypt. So giving bananas a little bit more of a wide berth when you're planting them away from seedlings, away from other support species. And what you were saying before about managing the Jerusalem artichokes or the sunchokes, that's a big part of like the syntropic agroforestry, like kind of figuring out that technique as opposed to just letting everything go to flower, is managing that senescence, managing the sunlight that's coming down into the understory. Because in any syntropic food forest, you look into the understory and you're going to have seedlings, right? You're going to have young tree species that you're wanting to eventually start to climb up into the canopy, but they're going to have a lot harder time with that if you're not managing the species that are ordinarily going to be dominating and taking that light. If you're not managing those species, whether it's the eucalyptus, the tree lucerne, the poplar, or the Mexican sunflower, or the sunchokes, the seedlings below are going to stagnate.
Yeah, absolutely. You need to keep that light coming in. That's the biggest thing, is keep the light coming in, keep the sugars back into the soil by cutting the top layer, and obviously everything you prune off the top, you prune off the root system as well, because it self-prunes. So making sure that you're pumping sugars in from the top of the soil layer as well as underneath the soil layer, and just really enriching your soil as fast as possible and as many times as you can as it grows. Yeah.
Yeah. A fun way to think about it is you're trying to increase the metabolism of your soil, right? You're trying to increase how much organic material can it chew through by dropping that organic material down. And what Brett's saying about pruning trees, they shed roots in response to that. So it's not just the organic material that sits on the surface of the soil, it's also feeding underground carbon material with the root shed that happens.
Yeah. And you can see basically the chop and drop has been piled pretty much along the edge of these beds. So you're getting quite a thick layer of mulch every time you chop and drop, and getting those into the midline so that it starts to feed. It's almost like in the shape of a V into your midline, so that as the water comes through, it actually drains in and pushes the nutrients down into the middle and feeds the root systems.
So organizing your biomass is a huge part of management, and learning what the most efficient way of utilizing your organic material is. That's been a huge learning for me as well, is just figuring out what's an efficient but also a really practical way of organizing the organic material in the food forest.
Yeah, and you know, it's all about trying to make things as easy as possible for you, whether you can mechanize it. You know, I've got things like these poplar in the midline, and obviously all of my shrubby sort of chop and drop are in the midline as well. So if I'm using something like a brush cutter or some kind of tool, I have to kind of navigate between the tree rows to get these things chopped, which is a bit of a pain, but my kind of way off is that over time these poplar are going to start to put on enough biomass that it's going to become worth that struggle for me. You know, I'm going to get enough of the foliage from these tree, from these leaves up high, that it's going to be worth the struggle of having to, you know, chop around them.
And eventually they'll probably replace a lot of the organic material that currently is coming from the comfrey, because the comfrey and the quick early succession herbaceous biomass is kind of just the first stage while you're waiting for the biomass from your tree species to come in.
It's like that first kind of 2 years, I think 2 to 3 years, and then they start to get shaded out and they lose the sunlight and they just don't produce as much mass as your tree species do anyway. So it's kind of like your succession of supports, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, so there's absolutely a succession of edible species, just like there's a succession of support species.
These lovely creeping gooseberries coming back through. I had a hell of a lot of them in this system last year. They pretty much took over, but not as many of them took as I would hope have, you know, to have taken this year. So
They weren't self-seeding as vigorously as you might have expected.
Yeah, I would have expected them to be a little bit more vigorous.
This is one of the avocados that was already existing, established in the space.
Got nice sized ones here, a couple of nice ones coming through. What have we got in here? Some taro and pineapples growing in the understory. Yeah. Some mulberries and sugarcane.
What are some of the main, actually, can you just rattle off as many different edible tree crops that you have in here? Just rapid fire as many of the edibles as you're growing?
Sure. We've got Davidson plums, bananas, we've got guavas, we've got citrus, mandarins, oranges, we've got lucuma, we've got...
And the lucuma survived the frost?
They did, yeah.
Awesome,
yep.
Cool.
We've got... barbacoa, we've got mountain papayas, inger beans, we've got white sapote, we've got cherimoya, we've got figs, macadamia nuts, feijoas, key apples, we've got a lot.
So I'm hearing so many fruit trees. What about some early succession? What were some of the earliest things you were harvesting out of here?
So, yeah, I
because that's what that's what makes a high quality food for us, is kind of what we're saying, is there's a whole succession.
Yeah,
so what was that early succession?
So the early succession for me was a lot of pumpkins, a lot of corn, tomatoes, different spinaches. We had a lot of annuals interplanted in these main crop rows, and actually even in the support rows, I had a lot of corn in the support rows as well. And I had a lot of produce come out last year, a lot of produce. I mean, I had something like over 100 pumpkins come out of these three rows. And on top of that, you know, tomatoes, enough to make, 10 liters of tomato sauce out of. So there were a lot of tomatoes, a lot of courgettes. Lots of annual produce just coming through. I didn't put annuals in these systems this year. Just because I found that the first year was really hard to manage creeping pumpkins through everything. It was really hard, and they actually did impact and affect some of the younger, smaller fruiting trees that I, you know, seedlings that I had in the system. They didn't get the sunlight they needed. I didn't manage them as well as I could have because I was waiting for the crops to come out of the annuals rather than just chopping them and allowing the sunlight in to those seedlings, which I would definitely do now in hindsight, but it's not something I managed very well. Obviously trying to get the value out of those annual crops before I got the value out of the later perennials. And I mean, a lot of them like obviously survived, but they were held back slightly from that. And this year I basically just didn't put any annuals in these rows. I've started kind of a market garden to test some of those annual growing crops out, which, to be honest, I'm never going to do again. So
you're not a market gardener.
I'm not a market gardener.
No. So basically what I'm hearing is in the food forest experiments, add all of your annuals in that first year except for pumpkins, have a dedicated pumpkin patch somewhere else so you don't have to manage the pumpkins kind of taking over the seedlings, but other than that, all the annual vegetables in that first year, just outrageous amounts of vegetables. Yeah. Now, is that something you would be doing again as you're continuing to expand more vegetables in that first season so that you always kind of have a supply of veggies each growing season rather than just in the first year doing your whole food forest and then, all right, cool, I don't get any more annual vegetables?
Yeah.
That's one of the benefits I see of kind of taking things in increments, bite-sized food forests each year, so that each year you have a new food forest to plant, which also means you have a new succession of annual vegetables to be harvesting with that new food forest. Is that kind of along what you're...
Yeah, but very selective on what I put into the main rows. So it won't be things that creep. You know, courgettes probably on the edge on whether I'd put them in a midline or whether I would put them as an alley crop in between rows. Pumpkins definitely alley cropping. Would not put them in the main rows. They just take over too much. Some beans I would put in. Broad beans I'd put in to a main crop, but I wouldn't put, you know, peas or anything that are too creepy into a main line, because they just really do just strangle a lot of things.
No creepy peas.
Yeah, no creepy peas. Yeah.
So we'll just take a little bit more of a wander and look at some specific details of the food forest and see what else we can see. We were saying before that things just look like they're finally turning into that young forest feeling. There's a bit of a height to the canopy now. It's starting to feel like a forest in here. Yeah, it's impressive the coverage that the yacon has. You can't see, like, just looking at the rows, it's really impressive that there's no mulch even showing. It's all vegetation. You're doing a pretty good job of maximizing your sunlight, Brett.
Yeah.
You got lots of yacon, you got the bananas capturing that, the eucalyptus up the top, citrus is just poking its head. It's doing well.
Yeah, and I mean this particular row, this yacon is actually due a bit of a chop. This would be the third chop this growing season for the yacon. It basically gets to shoulder height, and then I ended up chopping it. So these support rows are now, this will be the fifth chop on these support rows. So get a good amount of biomass out of them. And you know, I'm starting to experiment with a few other things in some other rows that I've got on some of the terraces. Looking at things like prickly pear supports, looking at things like just having Jerusalem artichoke as support rows, because obviously the Tithonia doesn't do too well in the frost, and in the systems where there's not a canopy, I need to have something that's going to come up every year without me having to constantly be putting stakes back in the ground or propagating beforehand and keeping them under cover to replant every spring. I mean, nothing's going to beat Tithonia for what it does, because it's just such a miracle support species. But if I can supplement the Tithonia and not have to do so much propagation every year and replanting of it due to the frosts, then, you know, sunchoke is a potential option.
Yeah, because it's not always available to people, to our friends in colder climates.
Yeah.
Now, what's been one of the unexpected things that you have really been enjoying about the food forest journey over the last 2 years that maybe you weren't anticipating?
Just watching the growth patterns of different species. You know, watching how things grow, how they respond to certain feeds, you know, when you're doing a chop and drop, and just watching how something reacts directly at the week to 2 week period after a pulse of that system. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've always really enjoyed watching things grow, but just seeing it, you know, in real time, every day, it's kind of my little getaway. I come out here most days, Byron rings me and I'm in my food forest. You know, it's just the way it is. I'm out here just observing. Like I say, I spend most of my time out here observing. The actual management of the system doesn't take that long, so it's not like it's a massive effort. I could probably manage most of what you see here in this first system in the space of half a day as a chop and drop. You know, I can do pretty much everything, both the canopy and the shrubs, in half a day, and you just get faster as time goes on. So it's the management of it is not massively time consuming, but the observation is.
And just the joy of being in the food forest.
Yeah.
What's a standout moment for you, whether it's this year, last year, or just something that really stood out to you?
I think watching a system being planted when we first put these two rows in, as you can see, there is quite a lot of space between the two rows. But at the end of the first growing season, I could literally not walk through these rows. The shrubs had grown across and touched. And to me, that was amazing that I could get that much growth in such a short period of time by, you know, constantly, the amount of stuff that I'd put in as a base for those plants to grow, obviously just did wonders the first year. It was just amazing. And obviously now there's a lot of space between things because I've just kept it pruned. You know, like I just, because that's part of Syntropic, that's what we're trying to do here. We're trying to keep these things pruned, trying to keep the sugars back in the soil. So it's been a constant prune for me this year. Like I say, fifth prune on these support rows, and going on to the fourth prune on the actual main grows now. So it gets a lot of pruning.
So one of those moments for you was just seeing how quickly everything explodes with growth.
Yeah, absolutely. And the difference is that I've watched, you know, I've planted fruit trees in other places on the land where it's been, here's a fruit tree in the middle of this grass patch, and here's a fruit tree in the middle of this grass patch. And I've watched how long it's taken those fruit trees to get to even half the size of some of the plants that I've planted in this system. And you know, some of those plants are like 4 years old, whereas these ones are not even two. So you can see what Syntropic does and the kind of pressure that they put on each other to fight for light, to fight for nutrients. Well, not fight for nutrients, but the way that they actually soak up the nutrients and provide for each other in a system, a cohesive system. So yeah, it's amazing to watch Syntropic work against, you know, a siloed plant out in the open.
Yeah, more traditional ways of planting fruit trees.
Yeah.
What's, and I might have an idea of what your answer to this might be, but what's been a heartbreak for you? What's been something that's been...
I think the same as your heartbreak. The first year were the frosts that came through for me. Watching a system do so well in the growing season and then come through a really hard, harsh winter where, you know, we got to like -5 degree frosts here, which because we're slightly higher up than Byron is over in his neck of the woods, we get slightly colder and more frequent frosts during winter. So it's a little bit more of a harsher environment for banana growing and for a lot of the subtropicals.
Well, and most people wouldn't even think that you could grow bananas if you're getting -5 degree frosts. And, you know, these bananas, sure, they're a little bit tattered this year from the recent storm, but they're growing and you're seeing flower bells and you're starting to produce.
Yeah, we've had our first two bananas flower this year, so that's really good. But, you know, I was told by many people, what are you doing? You're never going to grow bananas here. They're going to die. Like, you're wasting your money. And I thought to myself, well, hey, it'll be a fun experiment. Like, at the very least, we'll see what happens. And, you know, they've stood strong through their first winter. And with the canopy and the microclimate actually establishing more now this year, I'm very hopeful that they're going to do even better the second year through winter. So.
Well, it's been a pleasure, Brett. Thank you for having a walk with us through your food forest and giving us some great explanations of what's going on and what that process has been like. We'll check in another year, maybe a year and a half.
Yeah, that would be great. We'll see just how big these poplars and eucs are.
Yeah, that's right. Now, do you have any advice for somebody who just wants to get started? They just need that next step. What's that thing that is holding most people back that you can offer some advice towards?
I think fundamentally it's just, you know, start. Like, actually go and pick a little piece of land, start small, chuck in twice as many support species as you do edible species, and just plant them and watch what happens. Observe what does well, observe what doesn't do well, and learn from it. And, you know, you just have to pivot. If something doesn't do well, plant something else in its place, and just learn from it.
Lovely. Thank you, Brett. Hope you enjoyed that. Hope it was valuable. We'll catch you really soon. See you guys.